and gentlemen, what is going on? It's your guy Anthony Rose, and I am here live on After Hours. One second, let me adjust this. All right. It's the, you know, when you're live and doing a solo setup in the studio by yourself, that's what happens. We got a great show tonight. I'm super excited. We got an amazing guest, Ms. Shakira Pei. You know what? Matter of fact, let's see if Shakira is on right now. Let's say hi so you guys believe that she is truly here. Let me pull this over. And
me now?
Shakira, you there? Hey!
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 At 8:30.
I mean, I said I was going to have you on like around like 8:15, 8:30, but I just wanted to be
vegan. I just went vegan, so I can't talk right now.
Oh, so you got to eat like every like 10 minutes, huh?
Yeah. I'm not really a full vegan. I'm vegan-ish.
Vegan-ish?
I had chicken burgers, but I'm having vegan for dinner.
Okay.
Let me tell you, it's really healthy. Real healthy. I got to eat this first, though.
Okay.
You told me 8:30. Oh, maybe I mixed up the time. You said 8:00, didn't you?
I just wanted the people to know that you're here. So we'll be back. We'll be back. Right. Everybody say bye to the people.
Cheers. I'll see you real soon. I just got to finish my dinner because I need my nutrients.
Hey, we'll see you soon. Everybody, Shakira Pei is in the building. So a little backstory, I guess, is Shakira Janae Pei is from... she's from Brooklyn. I mean, I'm sorry. She's not from Brooklyn. She's from Baltimore. The home of many talented folks like Jada Pinkett Smith, Brisha Webb, actress, comedian, writer, maybe singer. She's multifaceted, young mini mogul. I actually met her through a mutual friend, Ashley Harrison, whose mom was one of my counselors in college. Go Huskies. And she was like, oh, you should go check this group out, improv and whatnot. I went to go check them out, and I was just like, yo, not only it was just an amazing show overall, but just to see a group of four talented black women like absolutely kill it, have fun, and just own who they are, and just with a lot of like depth, positivity, introspective analysis, educated conversation, and just funny intellect. So it is my pleasure, privilege to have her here as a guest on the show, and we are going to bring her in right now as I exit out of this slide and have a cool discussion just about who she is, what she has going on, and she is also the co-star in the new Netflix film, All Day and a Night, coming out tomorrow.
People say they want to know why. But they really don't.
I've been trying to figure out. Hey, Jack Core!
My father taught me how to take your life out on everybody else.
It's dog eat man out there. If he don't learn that in here, he ain't gonna make it.
My son won't be nothing like you.
I can't see even in plain sight.
Your old man used to run pretty tough.
Yeah.
Some people try to escape, get away from a world that wasn't safe.
I got something to tell you.
Well, what's up?
I'm pregnant.
Yeah.
It's crazy to have nothing to give. You want to give everything.
He's about to have a baby, but ain't trying to make no money.
Yeah, I know you got a couple bodies on you. If you're hungry, I'm going to put you to work.
How about tonight?
Job! You just like JD was. I'm done with you!
What did you do, Jacob?
Your father wanted everything for you. And now you have a son and you ain't even gonna try.
If you had all day and a night to understand your life, where would you begin?
Your life is in your rear view.
So, we are here live, ladies and gentlemen, with Shakira Janae Pei. Shakira, say hi to the people.
Hello. Hi. How are you? Y'all are here.
They're here. Okay. So we're streaming live to The Flow, to Code Black Life, Blueprint, the movies, my personal page. Just trying to get as much reach as possible. So, appreciate you coming on. First and foremost, like, tell the people, I said you were from Baltimore, but I know there's more to that. So you want to give them a quick background as to where you're from and all that?
Yes. Okay. Definitely not Brooklyn. I'm not from Brooklyn. No shade to BK. Baltimore. I like crab cakes and stuff from Maryland. I've lived in LA for a long time. Like, moved here before my 21st birthday. So just been enjoying the process. Like, just the best part of my whole life or my career. Like,
So Baltimore. You moved here when you were 20. Where did you go to school at? Did you go to the performing arts school?
I went to an acting conservatory called AMDA, American Musical Dramatic Academy. So got a bachelor's degree in performing arts.
Nice. Did you go to AMDA in Baltimore or out here in LA?
No, I originally moved to New York.
Okay.
And I studied at AMDA in New York for about a year and a half. And then I moved to California right after I finished the New York program and finished at the LA campus. AMDA's bi-coastal and it's tri-semester. So if you want to get out, go ahead. It's a great place to go.
Nice. So what led you, like, let's go back. When did you realize you were funny? When did you realize, like, you had that acting bug and you're like, was it like family members? Was it like, what was it?
Well, no, growing up, I mean, I do improv comedy, and I'm sure a lot of people don't really know, or if they do know improv comedy, they don't know black women doing improv comedy, because there's, like, such a handful that I barely know black women doing improv comedy. And as a child, or as a kid growing up, I was more, like, corny in the black community. Like, I wasn't fun. I was corny. I was more on the not, like, the cool person,
mm-hmm.
which is fine. I made up songs and I made up silly jokes and I had a lot of fun being exactly who I was. And once I was able to get out and be on my own, I found my people, and that's what you have to do. But I didn't get into comedy right away either. When I first moved to LA, I was just acting, and if comedy auditions came up, I did them. But I joined the improv community in about 2015, I'll say I was really in it, and I was on an indie improv team.
Nice. So what's the difference between, like, indie and pro improv?
So indie improv is just, like, people who like to make stuff up, and they might not be great at it, but they're practicing. It's like you go into the gym. So the indie improv scene is getting in the gym, lifting weights, and the pro scene is you're at the competition. You're at the track meet. So every other time I was just doing my laps and trying to prepare for my 400 meter run. And then now I am on the stage doing my 400 meter run. And you saw the show that you came to, you probably saw us closer to, like, you know, one of the games in the season.
Gotcha. Nice. Yeah. Okay. That's a good way to break it down.
I ran track in high school, so that's the only sport I have. I'm sorry, I can't do basketball.
You said you did what in high school?
Ran track.
Oh, yeah. You ran the sprints, hurdles, what'd you do? Long distance?
I wasn't fast enough. Let me tell you right now, black girls are fast. They are just fast girls, and they ran fast in Baltimore. So I immediately was pushed into mid-distance where I could, like, run a 400 or 800 meter and get a decent time and feel good about myself.
Yeah.
My turnover wasn't fast.
Yeah, the 800 is a beast. I remember my coach had me run one time, and I was like, nah, dog, I'm going to stick to the 4, or I'd rather do the mile. But then I ended up doing hurdles. So.
I love that you went from the 400 to the mile.
Yeah.
The mile?
Yeah.
The mile is a beast.
It is a beast, but
barely mid-distance to long-distance, almost cross-country running.
Yeah, well, the thing was is I ran cross-country. So, like, yeah. And my whole thing was, like, I was like, I'm just not going to come in last. That was my thing. I grew up in the Northwest, so we had, like, kids from Eastern Washington that ran through the woods for fun, you know? But then when I discovered hurdles, I didn't start running until my senior year. And then that's what, like, I really excelled in. So
it worked out. I love that you respect yourself enough to not come in last. Because let me tell you, I did cross country. And if you come in last in a cross country race, if anybody knows racing, it's sad. It's just sad. It's like 50 people running. I was second to last in a race once, and I was like, there were 48 participants.
Yep. And you know, running is a... It's such a mental thing because it's just you. Yeah.
It's a mental game. Especially long distance.
Yeah.
Long distance, you just are in your head for 3 miles, just like, I can run in about 7-minute miles if I wanted to, but I also can't because I can't mentally push myself to do better, or I can push myself to do better and I will, and I'm running 7-minute miles.
Yeah.
But I did a half marathon once and I ran 9-minute miles, which I was floored that I was able to do that.
Nice.
For 13 miles. So
you ran, what was your pace?
9-minute miles for 13 miles. Okay. I was 23.
Okay. I'm like,
you was
okay. Yeah. Cause, oh, I've been on the Nike running app. So I've been running a little bit more, but The longest I got was 4.75 miles, and that was like last week. So I'm working my way up.
I can do it now. I can't do it now.
You can do it.
If I work back up to it. But right at this moment, this quarantine moment.
Yeah, that's true. Now, would you say that the mentality you have to have for running helped you with your pursuit and success so far in entertainment?
Yeah, I think everything I've learned through my career in the time and just in this industry is that it's your mental health and your mental play, and not to be corny or, not to just like say things, but like it is a marathon. It really is. It's not a sprint. And if you come into it thinking it's a sprint, sometimes it is for a few people that just got it all tight, right? And the universe is, or in God is working his will, so you book a role within a month. But I think on average, the average person, the average actor I know, or person in the industry, it takes time.
Yeah.
And work, build. It's a practice. And just like doctors practice their skill, actors practice their skill.
Yeah. Now, you said something earlier about like being corny and nerdy and all that, and I can relate. But what was it, or who was it in your life that gave you that sense of confidence to be like, be you? Like when did that happen early on?
So I do feel like, so in elementary school, I felt like really in my own, like I felt like I could do what I wanted for a lot of the years up until I'll say fourth grade, when I started letting the kids around me affect my psyche.
Mm-hmm.
But before that, my grandfather used to overcompensate for anything that was lacking in my life. And he would call me boss, and I would be like, Si, I want some eggs. Si, da, da, da. So he let me like run the house, so I felt like I could do what I want. I feel like that's how I felt as a child. Even when I started taking dance classes when I was, you know, 5 and wanted to be an actor since I was little, my dad wanted that for me. And I didn't even know he wanted it for me. So it was kind of like I had everything in place before I let the world of people's thoughts get into my head.
Yeah.
And then when I got to high school, I went to a very open, liberally, kind of Caucasian high school, but it had a theater program, and nobody cared what I did, and I was in theater, and I was in a dance program, and I was just able to fully embrace, and I was embraced for, you know, I was the black girl who did theater, and people didn't, even if they hated me, they didn't say it to my face, like, you know, and I was able to, you know, dance down the hallway and be corny. And my best friend was the same. Like, you know, we like to make up songs and do corny, you know, weird stuff.
Yeah.
So I don't know if there was a particular person that was just like, this, embrace that about yourself. It was more so like, there were groups that accepted that side of me, and I didn't even fully I wasn't even self-actualized enough to be like, oh, this is why these kids don't like me, because kids can be really mean. So I did have a lot of kids who didn't like me, and I had a lot of kids who were mean to me growing up. Like, everybody has a group that got picked on. Middle school was, like, the worst. But, yeah, I mean, and my mom never, like, didn't, you know, was negative about my personality or me wanting to do stuff like pick up grass and put it in a bag with water and pretend it was drugs. Like, you know what I mean? Like, dumb stuff.
Hilarious.
No, I was just like, do whatever you, you know. I'm trying to take care of y'all. That's it.
So. Did you have siblings?
I have an older brother.
Okay, so you're the youngest.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But he's 9 years older than me, so it was like a huge gap between us growing up together.
Gotcha. Nice. Yeah. So when you came to LA, because you spoke about like finding your tribe and whatnot, did you find Obama's other daughters early, or what was that trek like to discovering each other?
So, I think when you come to a new city, you have to be patient. And you also, I mean, I look at every group, like people who go to church and then they all hang out with the people they went to church with, or people who are in a running club, or people who are at the same theater. Like, you find your tribe. And the improv community was that for me. I had already been in other groups and I hadn't fully felt like these people embraced me. And the most freeing thing is like doing improv in a judgment-free space. Or I mean, it is a little judgment, but overall it's like you can grow in this space. I felt like I could grow in it. And I'm making up stuff off the top of my head, and I'm attempting to do comedy until I am doing comedy. So like, once I found I took a class at UCB, and it's actually so corny because I didn't realize I could just make a team. And one of my friends was on a team, and she's like, a bunch of my members quit if you want to join. And I was like, oh my God, I'm like being invited to be on an improv team. And I was like the black girl on a team with four other white women. And it was totally fine because I was just happy to be able to create in the moment and have like a pressure-free space if that's what your heart is in. Yeah. So it took me a while to figure out where my heart was. But before that, I was just like friends with the girls I'm a hostess with at restaurants, and friends with my other server friends, and friends with my other actor friends from an acting class. But everybody's so deep.
Yeah.
And like, I need a certain level of levity in my life. Like, I need it to be fun. Like, what are we doing if we aren't having fun?
Yeah. I agree. And so like, I've seen you guys live a couple times. Like the first show was with Lunel. And then I was also doing my research and looking up just random Shakira Janae videos. And I saw one where you guys were at the Sonoma, improv, festival. And, the thing I thought that was really dope about it, which I want you to speak to, was like energy as an actress, you know, when you're on stage or in front of the camera, because you guys literally came out and it sounded like, they didn't show the crowd, but it sounded like there was only five people in the crowd. And you guys said something like, oh, there's only five people here. But the energy that you brought to it was as though you were presenting to 5,000. So can you talk about, for other actors and you people out there, about the importance of that, of being in that moment, but also how to get out of your own head of, you know, we all have that sense of disappointment where we feel like people don't show up for something that we're putting so much love into. But can you speak to that moment in situations like that?
Okay. Well, I'm first start off with, we were in Sonoma. So Sonoma is known for wine. So we had quite a bit of wine. but on the second end, on the positive, like true, and when you love what you do and you find joy in even making five people laugh, like, I think you're, you know, just, I'll just say you're closer to your purpose. Like when you can find joy in something, and like, it's hard. It's hard because a lot of times we do this, if you're doing it for just the audience and not necessarily for the love of it, or like if you're doing it for the accolades and not the love, then you're going to be disappointed every time.
Yeah.
You don't get you. I promise you. It doesn't always. You don't always get the applause on the things that you feel like you should, or even the acknowledgement. I mean, there's so many times we've had shows where I'm like, oh, killed it, and it was 5 people in the audience. I mean, especially improv. I know at least in the Black community, and back home, I don't know if any of my family has ever seen an improv show. Wow. They know I do it. They don't know exactly what that means. They haven't seen it. It's not in Baltimore. I mean, there is a small group. I do know there's a team, a community in Baltimore. It's a smaller community. But I'm just saying, like, I know at least my brother has never seen a show. My mom, my cousin. Like, so if you're expecting the audience to even relate to you as a Black improviser, you're going to be disappointed. So the people that are there that are supposed to show up for you will show up for you. And if they can't, then that's fine. You move on because you're not doing it for them. You're doing it for you. You're doing it for the greater good of the comedy world and just pushing what you believe is something important forward. So
yeah.
I said a lot, but hopefully some of it made sense.
No, I get it. Mike Dolphy just said one time for improv. So So speaking of like the people that show up for you, mm-hmm. What was like who was an actress or a comedian or actor that you looked at early on and you're like, wow, like I want to see myself doing what they do, if anybody.
So at least for a long time there was like a lull, at least when I first started acting. It wasn't a lot of Black women on screen. Kerry Washington was the first African-American female in a drama on a network series since the 1970s. And there was only one other before her. So, like, they would pop up and be co-stars and guest stars, but it wasn't necessarily their show. I would say Regina King was somebody, and is still somebody, that I found, like, I resonated with a lot. I feel like I love her. I've loved her for a while, and like now to see her really blow up, it's like she's been doing this, y'all. Even when I was watching that HBO show, The Leftovers, I watched The Leftovers in 2015, and she's on season 2, and she is phenomenal. Phenomenal. The best I've seen her, to be honest with you. Like, I've seen her great in other things, but like, I remember being floored and like rewinding scenes, like, oh my gosh, she's so good. And she's got a good sense of humor. And I also, it feels weird that I'm saying Regina Hall as well, but Regina Hall is so funny. She was funny even from Malibu's Most Wanted. Like, she's just been so funny for years and underrated.
Yeah.
She's underrated. I'm a writer as well. And recently, I'm co-writing a movie where I would love for her to play the lead. And so if y'all see a movie, y'all see my name in the titles. We manifested it. Right here.
Nice. Speaking of writing, it's tough. Like, I wrote my first feature a couple years back, and it was probably one of the hardest things I've done since pledging. Like, I felt like I was pledging myself because it's that muscle. So can you talk about that? Like, do you enjoy writing? Is it something where you feel like you get writer's block, or where do you find your inspiration?
Yeah, I think every writer gets writer's block. I think for me, the writing process took a little while. It took a little while for me to have the confidence in myself. I went to an acting school. So my last English writing, like English class for correct grammar and studying, was probably high school. So everything else I've done is the work I've put in as an adult. So I was just intimidated by the idea that it wouldn't be good enough, and or the process of, taking L's, writing stuff. And you know, it's crazy is, as soon as I got out of my own way is when things opened up for me on the writing end. Right now, my sketch team is writing a pilot for Comedy Central as a collective. It's going great. I was on a mod team at UCB, which is a house team. You remember how I described the track runners as the people practicing and the people on the field in the game? I'm in the game now.
Nice.
So I would say the hardest part about writing is rewriting. You got to be able to take notes and do the rewrite.
Yeah.
The first draft you put down is probably not the draft. And the first hardest thing actually about writing is writing. sitting your butt down and putting it on the page.
Yep.
That's the hardest thing. You have to just mentally tell yourself, I'm going to sit here and write. I'm going to turn this phone off. Turn it off. Don't turn it on silent. Turn it off. If you need to Google something, Google it on the laptop.
Yep.
Turn it off. Focus. Or you're not going to get it done. You're not going to write. Because to be honest with you, writing, especially in the beginning when you're teaching yourself to be a writer, unless you're Shakespeare, it's just like, pulling teeth. It's like, these ideas, and how do I get them into a concise, understandable way where people can relate and, like, I can share this story with the world? Because all you want to do is share the story. But thoughts and putting them on a page don't equate the story right away. So it takes work, and it takes a commitment, and it takes the being, disciplined.
Yeah.
You just got to be disciplined as a writer. That's all I'll say. Discipline.
What was the first thing that you wrote where you were like, yeah, like that first tingly feeling where you're like, I got some heat?
Every time you sit down and write, especially before you're actually getting notes, and you just writing stuff, and you don't know, and you putting it out there, you're shooting it. In the beginning, I was writing web series, and I was shooting it. I'll say my first web series is crazy. It's a hot mess. It's problematic. I should probably take it off the internet, but I worked so hard to do it and did it in 2010. So I'm not deleting it. And then my second one, the third episode, I was like, we got crazy good response. And I was like, so this is funny. Even the manager that I'm signed with now watched that web series and was like, I can tell you had potential from the episode three. And I was like, great. And then I will say on a mod team, I've written a few sketches, but there are a few sketches that pop up like within the past two and a half years, I'll say, because we're on Corona, so I haven't been writing.
Yeah.
But, or even down to the Game of Thrones sketch with Obama's Other Daughters, the way we write, we all pitch on the idea, or one person pitches like, hey, this is my funny idea. And then we all go in and add to it, but writing that, one of us is the head of the sketch, and it's whoever originally had the idea. So the Game of Thrones sketch was originally my idea, and I, felt great about that idea and great about writing the first draft of it and great about the feedback that I got from my teammates and the support and the jokes they added. Like, I felt great during that entire experience outside of the notes when we got notes from Comedy Central. Network notes are no joke. So got a bunch of notes. We did a rewrite and there was no dragon.
Right. Well, speaking of that sketch, I remember you actually let me read that and I was like, oh, this shit's hilarious.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But I was like, I don't know if I have the budget to pull this off for you, but it was great. And you just teed it up because I actually was going to just toss to that clip. So I'm going to pull in a clip from it. Hopefully I cue the clip I wanted up right. Of the Game of Thrones sketch for them to see a piece of it. So
we're holding out hope that Summer of Black will come.
This is the year.
I don't understand. Do you want to fight or do you want to die?
Honestly, I don't want to do either.
Hell no.
But it don't sound real bad.
It's freezing, John. This is not the weather of my ancestors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Besides, I'm not going to miss the annual black-only kiki to fight a white man's war.
Come on.
Say it again.
Preach. Okay. Come on, Preach. Somebody.
This is not the white man's war. This is all of our war.
Oh, your privilege is showing, John, and it ain't cute.
Mm-mm. What do you mean, my privilege?
Look around. We are literally the only black people here.
I'm sorry. Isn't our top unsullied gray worm a black?
What? Oh, my man with no dick.
Y'all just had to name the brown man worm.
Of course.
Okay, Khaleesi's right hand, Miss Sandy. Surely she must share your heritage.
I mean, I have not seen her at the hair salon.
Mm-hmm. Never.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm thinking,
Look at him reaching.
The Dothraki. Khal Drogo, wasn't he sort of black?
What is sort of black?
Sort of black, like... Sort
of... Huh? Who? Huh? What? Exactly.
Yes.
Khal Drogo might be dead, but I would have rolled that stallion in the battle.
I know.
Enough nonsense. We need everyone fighting. Winter is here.
No shit, bitch! Enough!
Sun-kissed people, I'm here to save you.
Not me.
Saying rode that stallion all night. So we are back. That clip in that scene to me, like, I love you guys' writing and your writing because, one, I think it's always, from what I've seen, saying what we're thinking. You know, the conversation had been for a while. There ain't no black people in Game of Thrones, and, you know, and so you guys, it's a great, like, intersectionality of the socio-political commentary, women's empowerment, and also not being caged into these traditional concepts of what femininity is. Like, you guys really own sexuality, your thought, your conversation, or whatever. And I think it's a great thing to see because a lot of those things are outdated in a way. So yeah, can you speak more to that moment though, and what prompted that overall, that sketch?
I mean, just like you said, we're saying the inner thought that a lot of black people are having at home. And as I watched Game of Thrones, I mean, by season 8, it's like, there was one random black dude who had 5 lines in one random season that I can't remember. It's like a sailor or something. And then no other ones. And we're in these Caribbeans and in these places. And it's like very clear that Khaleesi is saving brown people. And everywhere she goes, she is perpetuating the idea of a white savior. So it's like, everyone's having a thought, and then I just like to make light of it because it's like, of course I still love Game of Thrones. It's a great show. I mean, I would love some more black people. I would love, and even with Natalie, the girl who plays, you know, the ethnically ambiguous lead, I'm like, yeah, like, cool, but we would love some representation because African-Americans support the cinema. They support TV. They support movies. We've been invested in this for a long time. They've been getting our dollars, but it's like been taking years to actually get us on the screen the way we should be.
Yeah.
Because think about the amount of money that we put into the entertainment industry. We deserve every opportunity that we've worked very hard to get.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I feel like when I watched Game of Thrones, it was clear, like, this sketch should be made. There's no black people. It's not enough.
Yeah.
The one y'all do have, he don't have a dick. It's like, why are we doing this?
Right. The next sketch I wanted to pull up the clip is from the Black Card sketch,
okay,
the Jumanji thing. So it's going to make me exit out of 1 second.
It's a fun sketch. I love that one.
Yeah, it was, you guys, yeah. Let me slideshow, play from current slide. And I just need to tee up.
Oh, I can see you now.
You can see me now?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Now I can see you.
Won't he do it? Okay. All right. So, okay, I'm going to tee it up from this part.
What's happening?
No.
I can't stop.
It was 1995.
No, it's not. He's not winning.
Stampede!
Hey, Zaddy.
Looking like a red lobster cheddar bay biscuit.
Holy shit. You're the man of my dreams. I had a dream about you last night, and you're here.
Ew, you're not my type.
Where are you going?
Man, they said there was going to be white women here.
What?
Wait.
No, wait. No, please. Wait.
Oh, we're definitely locked in here.
Y'all, if we get the next one wrong, we lose. Like, lose.
Okay.
You heard it. Okay, cool. So, to me, that part is, that whole clip is great because it's like, you know, you guys take, like, these social colloquialisms and turn them into something more than, you know, than what they are, right? Because we say stuff like, for instance, I've still have yet to see The Wire, right? I know. And though most people would be like, all right, take my black card. Or like, my boy Jahan recently posted how he had never seen Players Club. And everybody's like, man, take your black card, right? So you guys play this game, your black card is gone. And I like that it was, to me, it was hilarious, that commentary on the guys running through and then being like, oh no, you're not my type, right? And then at the end, you guys turn into like white girls for real. So what was that conversation like when you guys were creating that sketch, and what were some of the decisions made of what to leave in and what to leave out?
Well, originally we did an improv scene, and before we did the improv scene in Sonoma, which is so funny you brought up Sonoma, we had a card game. I ordered the card game Black Card Revoked. So we played Black Card Revoked, and a lot of us got answers wrong. And so then when we were doing improv, we just thought of that scene. I don't know if we played, actually, we might not have played it, played that scene during Sonoma, but we did eventually do a Black Card scene. And when we went to write the sketch, we were like, what happened in the scene? Could barely remember, but we do remember, like, losing our Black Cards. And we're like, well, what happens? What if when you lost your Black Card, it just was, like, the worst thing ever? So Yasmin was the lead on that sketch, and she wrote, like, a draft where we all pitched in and added jokes and ideas to realize, like, what are the worst consequences to losing your Black Card? And the worst consequences, you turn into white women. And originally it was like you just get banned into the middle of a field in the middle of nowhere. But we decided to go with white women who look like and sound like, mm-hmm. or sound like the white version of us, yeah. which is just funny. Yeah, so the conversations were just like, what questions? Mm-hmm. Work with all of us, like with something, like even the Gucci Mane question that I actually said, like, I feel like Gucci's evolved. I didn't say he has evolved. Not that he's the most evolved person, yeah. but from who he used to be, if anybody know Gucci,
yeah,
prison Gucci is not Gucci who's Gucci now.
Yeah.
And that's just facts. So,
well, you know, a lot of people were saying that was Gucci, that clone Gucci, that wasn't him.
Right?
When he got,
that was the whole thing. Yeah. Especially on Black Twitter, they were like, yeah. that ain't Gucci.
Yeah.
He got a six pack now. This man has been in jail 3 times.
Yep.
Like, he's not the Gucci that was singing Lemonade.
Nah, at all.
Singing all those, she's a very freaky girl, yeah. even before Lemonade. Like,
yep.
Gucci from high school is not the Gucci that I know now in 2020. Well,
I say that's a testament to finding the right partner. Like, I mean, he got married and she flipped his bag. Like, she flipped, what, $1 million to $6 million? I mean, yeah. the right woman to get you right, you know? So I think that's part of it.
And too, like, I feel like you do the work. You can't, I think it's important to have a strong partner. But I also think it's important to do the work for yourself and not expect yep. a woman to fix you, because black women have been fixing black men for a long, not just black men, men in general.
That's true.
So I don't like the plight being on black women is all I'm saying.
That's true.
But I do appreciate like a strong partnership where you get a woman who really helps you turn money into triple that money.
Yeah.
And he did with Cora, what's her name? Couture?
It was like Keisha something. I don't know.
Yeah, Kior.
Kior.
Keisha
Kior. There you go.
There she is.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I'm with that. I'm a feminist. So I'm all for, you know. But yeah, I do feel like you definitely do have to do the work. And, you know, dating is a whole nether thing. Well, not another thing, because you guys kind of allude to that in your sketch. And because it reminded me of that scene from not How to Be a Player. Was it Don't Be a Menace, where Chris Spencer is all in the, he's in the Kente class, and he's like, excuse me, can you tap that Milk and Magnesia around the corner? You know what I'm talking about? Dang it, what movie was that? I gotta find it. But that conversation in dating, and with the corona, I feel like a lot of people are either deciding to do more self-work and internal fixing, or they're not. So, but with the thing with the guys running in and not paying you guys any attention, is that something all four of you guys have gone through out in LA, or was it just part of like the trope that is out there?
I will 100% say that dating in LA is not even close to dating in Baltimore. I can get off the plane and meet a man in the airport. In LA, it's like a little different. And even with, I mean, the black men in LA, not LA say LA, but like the ones that are, I guess maybe a little more Hollywood, not in the ones that are in the gentrified-ish areas are definitely not checking for black women necessarily. I mean, I'm not pressed about it, but I do notice, or I have noticed that in the past, even when I was like talking about the friends I used to hang out with, the hostesses ones, when we would go out clubbing and the difference in the treatment that I felt compared to my girls. And I was like, we're all equally beautiful. We're just different ethnicities. Mm. And, you know, I mean, the conversation isn't necessarily, is there a problem with dating outside of your race? I don't think that's a problem at all. The conversation is more so when you treat black women as if they're lesser. Mm-hmm. So that's the only conversation that could be had about the men dating white women. That, and that is common in LA.
Yeah.
Common, you know, major cities where, you know, other black men will prioritize dating outside of their race more than black women. Not, and that has nothing to do with the black women. It has to do with the black men and their mentality.
Gotcha. Well, I'm not in that group. This brother right here loves sisters.
I'm not a man. I'm just saying all of them are. I've dated black men outside of my race with Finn living in LA. So
yeah.
There's no shade to anybody. I know black women who date outside of their race. It's just saying like my experience.
No, I got you. It's a topic of conversation. I mean, ever since even in college when I was president of Black Student Union, we had a big thing and the girls were like, it was called, how do you like your coffee? I mean, we've been having this conversation for forever. But when, and with like the NFL draft recently happening and the images of like the white girls jumping on dudes' laps and moms having to pull them off. And I think when black men date outside their race, it's more of a conversation. But when sisters do it, it's like, oh, go ahead, girl, go get that bag or go get you that love. And, you know, but that's a whole nother conversation.
I think that's a way easier to minimize the conversation. Also, we're getting into a completely different conversation.
Yeah, we'll bring it back.
But I just want to say that I think minimizing the reason black women date outside of their race and comparing it at all to why black men date outside of their race is not, they don't equate. Most of the black women that I know who date outside of their race do so and are doing or just decided like, oh, black men aren't prioritizing or thinking that, not even prioritizing, treating me as an equal to Kim Kardashian. Mm-hmm. Like when we live in LA where people got body work and ass shots and boob jobs and it's just like you got all these people with so much to process. I know several black men who idolize that, and it's because they're brainwashed by the media. I don't know several black women who idolize white men the same way that I know a black man who are just, it's just a little, it can just be a little more problematic.
I got you
for every city.
Yeah.
I know when I go to cities where majority is urban and just integrated, and it's not about she got this job and this amount of money and looks like this. Like, it's a different conversation. But the ones that are the Hollywood niggas, that's a whole different conversation.
Okay.
And especially to think, like, I don't know black women that wouldn't date black men. Mm-hmm. I know black men who wouldn't date black women.
Okay. That's going to have to be another conversation in the future. But, I'm on the same page with you. But, speaking of relationships, in your new film coming out, tonight at midnight on Netflix. Wait, is May 1st tomorrow or is it the 31st tomorrow?
Yeah.
Oh.
Technically, it's probably out on the East Coast.
Okay, so it's out on the East Coast. So it was 12 minutes in. All day in a night is about a black relationship. It's with, I'll let you tee it up a little bit. Tell us about who's in it because I know, I don't want to mess up. I know Jeffrey Wright and then Austin, how do you say his name?
Sanders.
Aston.
You Sanders.
Sanders. So it's Aston Sanders, Jeffrey Wright, both phenomenal actors, and yourself a phenomenal actress and a host of other people. So talk about the movie and tell us about how you got involved in it.
So basically, as I said, I've been in LA auditioning for a while, and I had an opportunity pop up where I got an audition for the movie. And the role was great for me. And the casting director had met me several times and she was able to cast me finally. And I'm grateful for Kim Coleman. She's a beast. She has a ton of inspiring movies and TV shows and just projects in general. A lot of Black leads get cast through Kim Coleman. And yeah, so I went to Oakland, and majority of my scenes are with Ashton Sanders. He basically commits a crime, and then the whole movie we process and backtrack to how he got to that place and what pieces of the society around us helped contribute to the decisions he made and what he plans to do to try to live his best life moving forward as a criminal. And Ashton is an amazing actor. He's one of the leads in Moonlight.
Mm-hmm.
So I already was excited when I found out that he was playing the lead. Like, I was just like, great. Joe Robert Cole is literally the director. And he co-wrote Black Panther. And Black Panther is amazing. Isaiah... he's in Snowfall. So there's a lot of great actors. I'm ranting right now. Yeah. There's a lot of great actors and excellent performances. And I just am grateful that I was able to be a part of it.
Mm-hmm. Were you on set any of the days that Jeffrey Wright was on?
I showed up the day that they shot a prison scene together. I had a prison scene with Ashton the next day. And I saw Jeffrey just in passing, introduce myself, said hello, and that was the conversation.
Did you feel like he was, is he like a method, like in character the whole time he's on set actor, or does he go in and out? Do you know?
He was definitely focused on the work. I don't think, I mean, he wasn't like trying to engage like deep combo. It was like, hey, I'm an actress on the show. I mean, on the movie. Ashton was a little more like, yes, you're here. I saw your picture. Yay. And Jeffrey, I don't have any scenes with Jeffrey, so, and they were, like, in the middle of a reset, so.
Gotcha.
Met Jeffrey, I thought he was amazing. I mean, his work is great from everything he's done, and, like, even, right, recently, Westworld.
Yes. That's a whole, we got a whole nother hour conversation on Westworld. Yeah, I just, like, I'm always interested from a director point of view, just different actors' methods, as far as, like, let's talk about your method in terms of when you're taking on a role like this one, which is a girlfriend, from the trailer, that's all I got to go by, find out you're pregnant, you've got this guy that you care about, but he's caught up in some stuff. So how are you getting into that role? Are you staying in character the whole time? Are you drawing from experiences?
I draw from experiences. I'm the... I went to Amdur, so we did every, from Stella Adler to Miser to Stanislavski. Like, we do it all. It just depends on what teacher you have. So I like to sit in the character. I like to sit in the emotion so much so that it, like, just sit and feel it. And I don't walk around as the character. I haven't had a role where I felt the need to be in character outside of when I'm on set. When I'm on set, I'm focused and I'm just trying to sit in the feelings in the world and what's happening. I am an emotional person, so if I sit in a feeling long enough, I feel it deeply. But I also know, like, you do, like, you look up, like, you know, you write a backstory on the character and where they're from and how they got there and what their home life was and, like, something that triggered them when they were a child. And that's something that I do. I'm sure all actors don't do that. And you don't have to do that for all the roles, but for certain roles, like one like this in a gritty drama, you really just sit into it. So, I mean, my process for the audition is different than my process when I have the role. The process for the audition is get the script and the moments beat by beat and tight.
Gotcha.
You got a second to show you what you can do. You only get a hot second in that room, and if you don't do it right, then you're done. You don't get the job.
Yeah.
You get a lot of no's before you get yeses. So people who can get it right in the moment are the people you see on screen, even if they're not a good actor.
Yeah.
If you can book, if you can audition, you'll book.
Yeah.
Basically, I've been blessed enough to have the opportunity to do this movie and sit in a hotel room and write a journal for my character and, you know, sit in what her thoughts are and think about how she feels about her partner and everything. So it's great. I mean, I think everybody approaches different roles, approaches acting differently.
Yeah.
But I have so many different techniques that I learned from school that I approach every role with what I feel is right for that role.
Yeah. Now coming out of that role, like let's say a heavy role that's dramatic and you're taking on a lot of emotions. What is your self-care coming out of it? Like when you're done, picture's wrapped, like how do you pull yourself back? I've heard other actors talk about when they go deep into a character, it takes a week or so to get back to who they are. Is that the same thing with you or is it?
I feel like I could just have a good cry and I'll be out of it, depending on what the role is.
Put on some Mary J and be done.
If it's something that I don't have to cry about, if it's not a drama, then I'll laugh and reflect on how fun and funny it was. Or even if it is a drama, I can laugh and reflect. Yeah. Most of the time after I finish something, especially if it's a drama, especially if it's an audition and I had to be really deep and dark for a while, I'll just like turn on The Office and laugh and laugh on that, you know, that gives me joy.
Yeah, nice. And do you have a favorite moment from that film?
I feel like I'll say something then. There were like so many moments that it was just such a gem. It was it's a great experience. I had moments in my hotel room by myself, and just being in Oakland air, like it's so cold and crisp up there that it feels like just breathing fresh air. Even if the air isn't fresh, it feels fresh because it's so crisp.
Yep.
It's like that at the beginning of fall feeling.
Uh-huh.
And even shooting the scene with Ashton and Yaya and Isaiah, I remember like the slideshow. It's a bunch of cars and it was a cool night and I was a little cold, but like it was the energy, like the people in Oakland were so turnt and it was so fun and beautiful to see Black people like out showing out for a movie with cars that jump up and down and like, you know, getting hyphy. I don't know. That was a very fun night for me.
Nice. Well, I don't want to keep you any longer. We've been talking for a while now. I super appreciate it. I'm excited about it. We showed the trailer earlier. I'm going to leave the audience. Well, do you have any last words you want to say to the audience before we get out of here?
Check out the movie. It's on Netflix. It's great. Gritty drama. If you like that kind of film, thank you guys for checking us out and listening and hopefully add me on Instagram, @ShakiraJanae_. Anything I'm working on will pop up there. And then Obama's Other Daughters, my sketch improv team. We got some great stuff coming out soon. So please follow us and stay blessed, stay healthy, stay safe.
Nice. And you're actually the musical guest for the night. So we're going to end the show with Short Kings. Obama the Daughter, not exclusive, it's been out. So thanks again. Everybody, you said what?
I said watch all the sketches.
Oh, yeah, all the sketches. I'll put some links on my site as well to them. So we're going to end there. I want to thank everybody for tuning in to After Hours with Anthony Rose, my special guest, the talented, beautiful Shakira Janae Pay. I'm going to get out the suit because it's hot under these lights. And check out Short Kings by Obama's Other Daughters.
S-O-O-T on the beat. Some of y'all dudes let your height get to your head. So listen up.
Many types of men walking around this crazy village. This is a takedown of
high privilege. Most girls like he better be 6 feet. But for many valid reasons, we prefer Short Kings.
Short Kings are loyal. They put in work to spoil ya. Never hit a growth spurt, but always keep it royal.
Bitches have small spaces, so my house is extra clean.
Forget a tall guy, I wanna date a short king.
Short king. Don't sleep, holla at a short king.
can sell at these things. Short men got green, higher chance of romance, holla at a short king.
Being short is lame in high school, so they built up their character. This guy owns 10 businesses, vacations out in Florida.
Needs a step stool too, look into my eyes. But at least he making efforts, unlike them taller guys.
One case of rings, cause they always working. Financially and in my dreams, I think I'm short king.
If you a short king,
you a little side.
Napoleon don't mean nothing, the hidden gem of dating.
All the short kings dancing to the heavy track. Hottest thing up in the street since the epidemic of crack.
What they lacking in height, they packing in girth. Things so big, I hope it don't hurt.
His body type of teeth, so he sweat less in his crevices. Come in the room, all I smell is his freshness.
What matters in the club is your brand and your blank. And they got lots of both, cause they fucking short king.
Short, short, short king. Don't sleep, leap, holla at a short king. Stronger hamstring, lower to the ground, gonna bring the best spring. Short, short, short king. Be a jockey or play hockey, he didn't sell at these things. Short men got green, higher chance of romance, holla at a short king.
Where the short king at? Where the short king at? Where the short king at? Where the short king?
Hey, not for real. Throw up a flare or something, I don't see.
They got a job, and they work hard. Scores, never a bore. Statistically, they loyal beings, longer lifespans. Now do your dance. Hey.
I'm always the big spoon with you. Come here, let me scoop on you real quick.